Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Albaugh Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Albaugh.
Across Wisconsin on the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide on the Civic Media app. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Todd Albaugh, along with our producer and engineer, the fantastico Mr. Aaron Zommers on the board. Mr. Zommers, how are you on this Thursday, the 27th of July, 2023?
Well, I guess I'm fantastico.
Very good. That's what we like to hear. Let me just tell you this off the start of the show. If you haven't heard, if you haven't got out of bed yet at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, it's blazing hot out. All right. I know it's a first world problem. I mean, it's a global problem, quite frankly, but it is darn hot. We have a heat advisory in effect for much of the state of Wisconsin throughout the afternoon into this evening. And in all seriousness, if you have someone in your family who is an elderly person who might live alone, who might be immunocompromised, to have health problems, please check on them and make sure they're doing okay today.
Yeah, I was going to say it might be a first world problem for us because we're relatively healthy and have at least mostly climate-controlled buildings, but right. It is dangerous if you don't.
It is. It's super dangerous, and particularly for people that have no choice, that have to work outside. And so we're thinking of them today. Of course, the UPS folks that are driving the trucks around, I think you guys talked about that a little bit on Town Call before we came on here. But the union represents the Teamsters, representing the UPS drivers. Apparently, it seems, though, have won in the strike, gotten most of the concessions that they have asked for, including those air-conditioned trucks. So we congratulate them. And I mean, can you imagine? Think about this. I mean, heat indexes today are supposed to be like well over 100 degrees alone. Now drive around in a brown truck in this, unair conditioned. I don't care if they have white tops on the painting on the top or not. I mean, it's like driving around an oven.
Yeah, it doesn't matter what color it is. You're going to be bacon.
Yeah, bacon and in bits. So thinking about all those folks like our UPS, FedEx drivers, others who are on the road, milk truck drivers, folks that might not have air conditioning today, farmers, of course. My granddad were alive. He'd say, suck it up. You know, I mean, he finally, his last tractor was a Deutz, a German tractor, green Deutz. And it had air condition, had a cab, had air condition. But I think all the tractors, Minneapolis, Moline's before that, there was no air condition. It was just out in the elements. So thinking of all of our farmers and ag producers today as well. Going to go on a couple of issues today. Going to start off with the Trump indictment. It looks like Donald J. Trump is going to be indicted once again, this time for January 6th. We're going to break this down courtesy of Robert Costas, from CBS, great reporter over at CBS. He has laid out a lot of this in order. We're going to go through this and take your calls as well. And also in this, probably this hour, we'll see how the first subject goes, but was out in Richland Center last night. The RC in the drift list, we had Kat Hadley from Patriotic Millionaires on yesterday. They had another one of their sessions last night. Great attendance at the Phoenix Center in Richland Center. Dewey and Andrea doing a great job fixing a great meal there at the Phoenix Center in Richland Center. And really a great program. And one of the people last night asked the question, why are you here? And if you haven't joined us before, Patriotic Millionaires is literally a group of millionaires throughout America who have said, you know what, we've done very well, we're thankful for that, but we simply don't feel that we're paying our share, fair share in taxes. And that if people like us, the 1%ers paid a little more, that means that folks on the bottom would pay less and have more, and it would make our community stronger. And they don't focus on the cultural differences, you understand. There's no talk of you know, abortion or you know, LGBTQ or any of those things that are very important issues but tend to drive people apart. What they just say, we're here to talk about one thing, money, and how taxes affect the money that we have. Really smart idea. And so one of the people last night at the meeting in Richland Center had a great question and simply said, why are you here? 5,000 person town in Richland Center. And they pointed out that one of the main reasons they're here is to help empower you, to give you information, the facts, so that you then can go to your legislators, both state and federal, and start asking these questions and pin them down and demand that they do better in the legislature and in Congress. And even that, I could tell there's some skepticism from folks like, well, you know, can we really make a difference? Well, we're going to go through later this hour a great story from the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel from back in 2018 that pointed out that Richland County in particular from 1990 through 2016 was one of only 19 counties in America, in the United States of America, one of 19, that had voted the same way that the eventual winner for the presidential election. So from 1990 through 2016, they voted, Richland County voted the same way that America voted in electing a president. So it's a bellwether county in America. And then the Journal Sentinel looked at Southwest Wisconsin, kind of just south of La Crosse. Our listeners there on the Eagle in La Crosse, all the way kind of over to Baraboo, and then down to Monroe, that whole southwest quarter, kind of the Driftless area, how that is a very swingy part of the state. I'm not talking about swings in the basement. I'm talking about the way that they voted back and forth between Republican and Democrat. So we're going to take a look at voting in Wisconsin. Why, once again, Wisconsin's going to be so pivotal in this race in 2024. And, of course, your calls as well, 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789. Come on back now. This is the Todd Allball Show on a hot Thursday afternoon on the Civic Media Radio Network.
Mr. Sandman, bring me a dream. Make him the cutest that I've ever seen. Give him two lips like roses and clover. Then tell him that his lonesome nights are over.
Welcome back to the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. It is now 15 past the hour of 1 o'clock on a Thursday, the 27th of July. Mr. Sommers, I had that song in my head today when I came in the studio, and he dialed it up. It's appropriate. It's appropriate because it feels like we're in a dream, once again, with yet another, it looks like, indictment of Donald Trump on the horizon. And before I get into that quickly, I was remiss in my opening comments there for the show. Today, the 27th of July, the birthday of my fine father, James Allball. So congratulations. Happy birthday, Dad. Jim Allball up there in Shawano, or as they say locally, Shawano. No, they don't. That's how it's spelled. It looks like Shawano, but it's pronounced Shawano. Was up there this weekend, saw him and my stepmom, Mary, so that was fantastic. And I believe they are traveling across the state through Bull Falls Radio Land over to the Tap Country in Eau Claire. And got to see my sister and her family in Eau Claire. So.
Although speaking of things with music and the show opening,
yes.
We just got a text from somebody listening in Madison saying that they love the George Michael theme music. Always puts me in a good mood while doing housework and listening to your show.
Well, fantastic. I appreciate that. Thank you. I picked that up. Mr. Zombers and I worked together on it. But I'm a big George Michael fan. Just think he was a fascinating personality, largely misunderstood, had a lot of demons like a lot of musicians and artists do, like we all do. I think he has a great voice. And I just love the tune. And also it talks about freedom, which it doesn't matter whether we're Republicans or Democrats or independents or whatever. We all are after freedom. I think it represents this show. We're pursuing the truth wherever it may lead. We're pursuing freedom for everyone. We want people to be free in this country. Good gosh. Right?
All we have to see is that I don't belong to you and you don't belong to me.
That's right. Great. Some great lyrics.
Yeah, freedom.
Some great lyrics as well as that song, Freedom. Well, thank you. We appreciate that listener here in Madison on WMDX. You can text us at 844-967-2789. The best way to text us is to download the Civic Media app. You can do so by going to your app store on your Android or iPhone device. Simply type in the search bar, Civic, C-I-V-I-C, Civic Media. You can download it. Takes less than a minute. It is free. It's what Gail King over there at CBS calls a deal, right? Free in less than 1 minute. Download the Civic Media app, and you can text. There's a little button now right there on the app that says text, and also call. Or do it the old-fashioned way. Pick up the phone, 844-967-2789. 844-967-2789. So a top story at this hour across many of the news networks, including CNN, Donald Trump this afternoon is saying that his attorneys had what he's calling, quote, a productive meeting with the Department of Justice this afternoon. He's trying to buy himself a couple of weeks, according to reports. Grand jury hearing evidence of the special counsel probe at a meeting today. If you were listening to Matt Flynn yesterday on Matt Flynn Direct, as I was, Matt Flynn believes an indictment is coming down soon, yet again, this one revolving around January 6th. But as Matt Flynn likes to say, I love this saying, hey, an attorney can indict a ham sandwich, right? It just means that the burden of proof to get indictment isn't real high, generally speaking. Has to be a really weak case not to get an indictment from a grand jury. So here now, this is reporting from Robert Costa, great reporter at CBS, put together this line of tweets. I think it's fantastic. It kind of shortens this all up and explains it to us. So I'd like to go through this a little bit and invite your calls. What do you think on this pending indictment, this one revolving around January 6th? For the Trumpster, 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789. According to Robert Costa, he says, hours after the polls closed on November 3rd of 2020, shortly after 2 a.m. on November 4th, day after the election, Trump falsely claims he won. What was discussed in the campaign war rooms in both the map and the map room? What did Trump say? What pressure was put on Fox executives, Department of Justice officials, and political officials? All right, that's the first thing they're going to look at. On November 4th, day after the election, did Trump privately tell others he knew he had lost? This is where some of the Mark Meadows stuff comes in. Other people around him who the grand jury has brought in under oath and talked to him. What did Trump basically confess or admit to those around him? Look, hey, I know I lost, but we're going to try to win this thing behind people's back. Did he say anything like that? Did he suggest it in any way? According to Robert Costa and other people, other attorneys, this is a crucial point. Because if Trump admitted to those around him or inferred that he knew he lost, and then went on and did these actions anyway, that goes a long way to it, what in the legal terms they refer to as intent. Unlike Matt Flynn and Maggie Dawn, another great program at 6 o'clock here on the Civic Media Radio Network, I am not an attorney. I don't try to play one either on the radio or streaming. I have worked for an attorney, spent a long time in politics, so I understand the law, but I'm not here to give out legal advice. But I can tell you that in legal parlance, what grand juries and judges will look for in particular is the intent. The intent of a defendant. Well, I mean, so the guy made a mistake, the girl made a mistake. Clearly, it looks like the law was broken, but what was their intent? So what Trump told people on the early morning hours of November 4th matters a lot. They're going to focus on conversations that Trump had on November 4th of 2020. Here's one of the quotes that's been leaked. Quote, how the hell did we lose the vote to Joe Biden? Unquote. Trump allegedly asked that of Kellyanne Conway on those early morning hours after the election. Wanted to know how he lost. On November 6th, Rudy Giuliani arrived at Trump headquarters in Arlington, starts to claim that he has countless affidavits about election fraud. What did he tell Trump's lawyers? Did he put anything into motion? Later that day, Giuliani and others in the Oval Office discussed court strategy. What was said? See, all this is building a narrative for Jack Smith, the prosecutor. Moving forward to November 7th. The Associated Press declared Joe Biden the winner. And of course, Donald Trump erupts. Mitch McConnell stays cool, doesn't want to rattle Trump. Has Senator Cornyn privately tell Biden a confidence to not have Biden call McConnell. Said, look, just don't have him call me. I don't want to interact. Here's the quote from former Senator, from Senator Cornyn. Quote, we're in a delicate situation. It won't help things if Biden is calling. So that was going down kind of behind the scenes. And again, this is reporting of Robert Costa of CBS News. On November 7th, Hope Hicks, another Trump confidant, meets in Arlington, wonders if Trump will concede, if he can eventually find a way out of this. Several Trump advisors go to see Trump a bit later, and he brushes off that talk about conceding. And then, of course, you had Giuliani at the Four Seasons. Remember that? Giuliani and the Trump people were going to have this press conference to talk about how Trump won. And they went online to book the Four Seasons Hotel. Well, they were so incompetent that they booked they gave out the address to all the press of Four Seasons Landscaping.
It's honestly impressive. I feel like anytime I hear that story, I also think about there's a restaurant in Manitowoc called Four Seasons. And I just keep thinking, like, what if some of them showed up there? Like, it's not even the right state, but I wouldn't be surprised.
It could happen. And of course, that was a debacle, but they tried to pull it off like, oh, no, we meant to be here. On the evening of November 7th, Trump's furious in a White House meeting. Trump pressures allies and advisors to fight on, not to waver. Dismisses talk of calmly working the courts. Scowls at talk of conceding. What did he say? Did he articulate plans to pick up thousands of votes in various states? And if so, how? On November 8th of 2020, Trump ramps up his plans to fight Biden's victory. Sidney Powell, attorney, Giuliani are seen entering the White House together. What happened at that meeting? November 9th, Trump seeks a tighter grip on the cabinet. Mark Meadows, then chief of staff, calls Secretary Esper, says he's out. Not supporting Trump enough, so they got rid of Esper. On November 9th, Pence's team is on edge. Wants to show solidarity with Trump. Pence tweets, quote, it ain't over till it's over, unquote. But privately, Pence allegedly said, quote, get him the hell out of D.C., the hell out of crazy town. That according to Pence advisor Marty Obst, who tells Mark Short and then Pence's chief of staff. So again, we allegedly, under oath, have all these people around Trump, including Pence's top people, saying that Pence privately saying, get Trump the hell out of D.C. He lost. It's over. Pence knew it. On November 9th, Pompeo meets privately with General Mark Milley, Joint Chiefs of Staff. Says, quote, the crazies are taking over. That's what Pompeo says. Mike Pompeo, Secretary. The crazies are taking over, he tells the chairman. At that time, Flynn, Powell, Giuliani, Lindell, that's right, the pillow guy, the My Pillow guy. Think about this. The My Pillow guy is in White House meetings with some of the top people of the country at the time in 2020.
We're truly in the bad timeline.
I mean, this is remarkable stuff. Think, you turn on your television, you can't miss the guy. He's trying to bring his company back in Minnesota because so many people aren't buying it. A, the product is crap. And B, the guy is spooky crazy. The My Pillow guy is conspiring with Trump's people in 2020. This is what Pompeo says to Joint Chiefs Mark Milley, who again has testified under oath to this grand jury. Quote, he's in a very dark place right now, unquote, he's saying of Trump. Again, this is reporting by Robert Costa from CBS News on this impending indictment of Donald Trump, the newest indictment that is allegedly coming down, could come down today. Still waiting on news. This, according to Robert Costas, is just some of what's in this reporting. On November 10th, Intel officials alarmed following Esper's firing, of course, the defense secretary. What is Trump up to? What's going on? Quote, "We are on the way to a right-wing coup," unquote. That's what the CIA tells Milley. The CIA tells the Joint Chairman, Chiefs of Staff, quote, "We are on our way to a right-wing coup." That's what people were saying back in 2020. That's the evidence they allegedly have on Trump. What do you think about this? 844-967-2789. Back with more after this. Don't go anywhere. This is the Civic Media Radio Network. Pursuing truth wherever it may lead and having fun doing it. Good afternoon. Welcome back to the Todd Oddball Show. It is now 1:33 on a Thursday, July 27th, 2023. Happy birthday to James Oddball, better known as Dad, celebrating up there in Eau Claire, Wisconsin today. Hope he's enjoying himself. Staying cool. Hope you're all staying cool. Again, in all seriousness, this heat is going to stick around for a little bit. Maybe some heavy weather coming through, I believe, tomorrow. So be aware of that. But in terms of heat, several heat watches and warnings throughout the state of Wisconsin. Take care of yourself. Stay indoors in a cool place if you can. If you're an elderly person that has breathing problems, take care of yourself. Check on those people that you know and love. Have to take care of each other in this kind of environment. Invite your calls this half hour, taking on this, what looks like, still checking the wires, looks like no updates so far, other than according to Donald Trump and the people around him, he says that his attorneys had quote-unquote productive meetings with the Department of Justice earlier today. It appears that Jack Smith is looking to hand down yet another indictment, criminal indictment, against Donald Trump, this time for the events surrounding January 6th, 2021. And working our way through this long thread of great reporting by Robert Costa at CBS News, who's going through this timeline. And this, I think it's helpful because as we move forward and take calls and have discussions, I don't want it just to be a yelling match or you're only going after this guy because he's from the other side. You have to look at the facts. Have to look at the facts. And you have to realize what has transpired, what the Department of Justice allegedly has on Donald Trump.
A quick note, we have a Facebook comment. Yes. Now if you comment on our streams on Facebook or Twitter or whatever you want to call that we can share it on the stream. We have a comment from frequent caller and contributor Jeff Perry.
Yeah.
Who says, like Dave Letterman would say, today is 99 and miserable, like Rupert Murdoch.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. 99 and miserable. Yes, thank you. It's fantastic. Thank you, Jeff. We appreciate that contribution. You could go on the Facebook and on the Twitter. I'm not calling the X. I'm still going to call it Twitter. Go on Twitter, Facebook.
Like everyone else.
Or the Civic Media page as well. Join in the fun. We're streaming live on the new StreamYard. I don't look any better, but the design around me looks much better. So that's exciting. Or you could call into the phone line, 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789. So let's continue on now with this reporting from Robert Costa from CBS News, allegedly what the Department of Justice, Jack Smith, now has on Donald Trump. This is the reason the indictment allegedly is coming down either today or very, very soon. Picking up this timeline, going back to November 10th of 2021, pardon me, 2020. So the Intelligence Committee is alarmed following the firing of the Defense Secretary Esper. And so CIA goes to the Joint Chairman of the Chiefs of Staff, Milley, and says, quote, "We are on the way to a right-wing coup," unquote. On that same day, November 10th, in the Oval Office, Donald Trump allegedly said, quote, "I don't care about my legacy," to Hope Hicks, unquote. He says, quote, "My people expect me to fight," unquote. November 11th, seeking more influence at Department of Justice, then Chief of Staff Mark Meadows floats Kash Patel becoming the deputy FBI director. Bill Barr, the attorney general, said, quote, "Over my dead body," unquote. This is fascinating stuff to me. Because, I mean, Bill Barr is no saint, you understand. And yet, even Bill Barr says some of these people that Trump wanted to put in, quote, "over my dead body." This is good stuff. On November 12th, 2020, the Department of Homeland Security, Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency stated that the election, quote, "was the most secure in history," unquote. And Donald Trump erupts. They fired Chris Krebs. The question, what did Trump say? Did he pressure officials? On November 19th, Sidney Powell and Rudy Giuliani are at the Republican National Committee. They're pushing these false conspiracy theories of foreign influence on the U.S. election, which none of it was true. Completely unsubstantiated. In the West Wing, pushing aides to be loyal to Trump, making wild claims, Giuliani and Sidney Powell are. Some of the aides begin to resign, others decide to stay. Fast forward to December 14th. That's when the Electoral College cast their ballots. It was a turning point. After weeks of wandering around and conspiracy theories and losing court battles, things are grim inside the Trump White House. Many House Republicans back the friend of the court brief backing the Texas lawsuit asking South Carolina to block, pardon me, the Supreme Court to block some state counts. They're trying to basically do the same thing that happened in 2000, trying to say we're going to stop a recount. Mid-December, Sidney Powell begins pushing Trump to issue an executive order to take control of the vote count, culminating in the infamous December 18th, 2020 meeting featuring a large group of aides shouting over whether Powell should be brought into the White House, voting machines seized. I mean, I'm trying to do it more in a news fashion and not get too dramatic about it. But again, we've had a lot of writers on this show lately. If you'd have a writer's meeting and pitch this to an executive, I don't know they'd take this script. It's too crazy. It's too predictable. I mean, to have the president of the United States and people around him suggesting that they should take control of voting machines by presidential authority. It's no wonder that an indictment is coming down any minute. Fast forward, according to this reporting from CBS News' Robert Costa, mid to late December in 2020, relations between Giuliani and Powell fray. Attorney General Bill Barr dismisses the idea of appointing a special counsel. Trump is irate. "Don't worry," Giuliani and others assured him, "we still have another play." Mike Pence. Late December, Pence, under pressure, talks to former Vice President Dan Quayle. Remember him? George H.W. Bush's Vice President, Dan Quayle? Pence talks to Dan Quayle and his lawyers. What can he do? Turns out, nothing. But plays out his deliberation. So Dan Quayle allegedly told Mike Pence, look, you can't do anything. It's over. Several members of Congress wonder what they could do. Several Trump aides tell them to talk to someone developing a memo. Who was that? John Eastman. Of course, John Eastman came to Wisconsin, talked to Robert Voss. And even still, after Joe Biden was sworn in, John Eastman trying to convince Robin Voss here in Wisconsin to try to overturn the results in Wisconsin. Going to go to the phone lines in just one moment. Want to finish this up. Reporting by CBS News' Robert Costa. December 30th, 2020, an escalation. Talk becomes action. Senator Josh Hawley of Missouri announces he will object. Other GOP senators sign on to object. Movement to do the same in the House grows. That same day, a tweet from Donald J. Trump. It says, quote, January 6th, see you in D.C., exclamation point, unquote. December 30th, 2020, Bannon speaks privately with Trump by phone. Allegedly said this, quote, you've got to return to Washington and make a dramatic return today. You've got to call Pence and call Pence off the effing ski slopes and get him back here today. This is a crisis. We're going to bury Biden on January 6th, unquote. Allegedly, this is the evidence of the grand jury. Early in January, a fever pitch. January 2nd, the Eastman memo circulates. January 3rd, Pence meets with the Senate parliamentarian, clarifies he has no authority. January 4th, Trump pressures Pence into the Oval, and Eastman is there. January 5th, Trump one-on-one with Pence in the Oval. Meanwhile, Willard in the war room takes charge. And ultimately, CBS hears a special counsel is looking closely at key junctures in post-election period where Trump spoke about his intent. Let me say that again. His intent to overturn the election and how he explained his plan to do so with all pressure points explored, investigating an alleged conspiracy. See why I brought up that word intent early on? It appears that Trump expressed intent of overturning the 2020 election. 844-967-2789, 844-967-2789. Let's go to the phones. Mark in the sack, appreciate you holding, my friend. What say you?
Well, not a problem, and thanks for taking my call. And it's disturbing to me that there's 63% of Republicans, apparently, that don't think that Joe Biden is legitimate president of the United States. They don't think he actually won the election. And the only reason they're thinking that is because all these Republicans for years now have been saying that, you know, that the election was stolen from them, the election was stolen from them. And every single one of these politicians, these Republicans and their aides and their lackeys and all their little confidants that participated in this that should be ejected from office, they all have violated their oaths of office. I mean, their duty is to the United States, not to Donald Trump. And I mean that, and I have to be really careful to avoid any FCC, you know, because it's...
Appreciate
just,
that.
I mean, I'm spitting tacks right now because yeah. These guys, I mean, Robin Voss and all those, you know, that Fitzgerald and a host of other Republicans in our state house right now participated in this, supported this. This nonsense that they're going to stand by Donald Trump and overturn the election. I mean, none of them belong in office anymore. Period.
Yeah.
I mean, the fact of the matter is they've clearly violated their oath of office. Their oath is not to Donald Trump. It's not to their party. It is to the Constitution of the United States, and their duty is to uphold that Constitution. The fact that they did not, when they heard this stuff going on, that Trump is pulling this stuff, they did not come out and say, this is what Donald Trump is doing. And didn't report it. I mean, yeah. It goes to show that they have no character at all, period. I mean, I can't imagine that some of the, you know, even Tommy Thompson, who I have big disagreements with, if he's in a position to know this stuff is going on, mm-hmm. They're asking about this stuff, would have been shouting the clarion call. Dale Schultz would have been shouting the clarion call.
Mm-hmm.
These guys have no business being in office. And the first question they should be asked, what do you think about this? And unless they're able to say that Donald Trump betrayed his oath of office, that they have no business being, you know, that representatives of the people, because they have not represented the people. They've represented themselves and whatever corrupt group of supporters that they actually have. I mean, it's just, maybe I'm being hyperbolic here, but these guys are just, they're traitors to their oaths, and they're traitors to the people, they're traitors to the United States, and they might not like that, might stand that, yeah, but TS, I mean, it is just...
Mark, let me ask you this. I went through, I love your calls. I appreciate you listening. I know it took a long time going through that timeline. I thought it was great reporting by Robert Costa at CBS News. And the reason I did this is because I want to be on the record of going through and laying out what the evidence is, allegedly, by Department of Justice. And when you hear that in sequence, and when you hear it and look at it, and the quotes that allegedly Department of Justice has, and this is probably only just a small part of what caused this, what seems to be a forthcoming indictment, I'm just amazed by that. I got 20 seconds. What are your thoughts?
I'm amazed too. But we knew that some of the stuff, while it was happening, we knew some of the stuff was going on. We knew that, you know, that Trump was getting advice, just declare yourself the victor. And
I agree with you, Mark. Got to cut you off. Sorry. Back with more after this on the Todd Allball Show. Back to the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network, where it is now 10 minutes before the hour of 2 o'clock. At the top of the hour, check in with a little network news across America, around the world. Some state headlines courtesy of Terry Bell and the Civic Media News team. A check of weather, and then back with our second hour. Talking this hour along with Mr. Aaron Zommers, our producer and engineer, wanted to take time to go through. I know it was detailed. I know it was a lot of stuff there. But I want to be on record, and I haven't found a better, more concise timeline to January 6th than this Robert Costa reporting at CBS, laying out in detail some of the alleged quotes from people who said these things under oath to the special prosecutor, Jack Smith, and apparently now from all reporting across many networks, and Trump verifying himself that his attorneys met with special counsel today, we're expecting yet another indictment, a criminal indictment, this one focusing on January 6th, and Trump's involvement, and it all goes back, or much of it goes back again, to his intent. What did he intend to do? Allegedly, he appears that he intended to overturn the election, knowingly, allegedly. What say you? 844-967-2789. 844-967-2789. Let's go to the phones up to beautiful Marshfield. Mike in Marshfield, are you listening to us on Bull Falls Radio or WFHR? Or on the app?
WFHR.
All right, fantastic. Great station up there in WFHR. What say you, Mike, on this subject?
Well, my question is, have you read Trump's speech from January 6th?
It's been a while, but yes, I've gone through it and seen it. Yes.
And in my opinion, when I read it, there was nothing that said, I don't know what word you want to use, where he's been charged with things or they continue to keep trying him with things. You know, he says we got to fight for things, like pretty much every politician, every coach. I used to coach my kids in cage club and AAU basketball, and I said, you got to fight for that ball, different things like that. If you read his speech, the per words, I don't know where there's any incitement or whatever your words they want to use. But the thing regarding January 6th, I don't know how you can prove what his intent was. I guess when you look at that was 2.5 years ago, January 6th, or more than 2.5 years ago. Don't you think that the Democrats they're scared of Trump? I mean, why else? If he wasn't running for president, we wouldn't be talking about this right now, would we?
I would hope so. I think that I'm one that thinks that you should follow the law, you know, and whether it's pursuing the truth or pursuing the truth of the law. And I don't care whether it's Donald Trump or Hunter Biden. I think that every case where the law is violated should be, the evidence should be laid out. People should have a fair trial. You should have a trial of your peers, and whatever that jury decides, that's it. So I believe in following the law, whether the guy's running for president or not. I think you make a great point about the speech. I don't know, in everything that's reported by Robert Costas here, or Robert Costa from CBS, all his reporting here, I don't see anything where he mentions Trump's actual speech on January 6th. What he's laying out here, and this is allegedly what he got in his reporting from the Department of Justice, what they have, or at least partly what they have, the evidence they have, the reason why they would bring another indictment, is all these meetings that happened either in the White House House with Sidney Powell, with Rudy Giuliani, Mark Milley, all these people, where he's telling his own advisors behind closed doors what his intent was. And these people then testified under oath to this grand jury. So I don't see anything in here, to your point, about the speech that Trump made, although I would say that, say, quote, we're going to march down there, we're going to march to the Capitol, and we're going to give them, we're going to fight like hell. I think that was inciting something that he already set up. But the speech alone, I mean, that's free speech, right? I mean, I don't think you can necessarily charge a guy with an indictment over a speech he made.
Yet they did. They impeached him again over that.
I don't believe it was simply over that speech. I think it was many of the things that I've just laid out here by this other reporting, where you had the Joint Chiefs of Staff allegedly telling the Attorney General and others that we are approaching a right-wing coup based on evidence that Trump's own government had.
So, and fair enough. I don't know what went on behind closed doors. If he actually said to his top advisors that my intent is to not allow Joe Biden to be confirmed. Now, if he said there's a reason for it based on the law, this is the reason. I think that's different than saying my intent, my goal is to not leave office under any circumstances. Sure, then I think we've got an issue there.
Right.
But if he said based on this, this is what our plan is moving forward. Again, I don't know the law. I know the Constitution. I've read it. Mm. I'm not an expert on it. I know there's, you know, I know this with law because I've been in the courtroom enough.
Sure.
one lawyer tells this story. The other lawyer tells this story. It's who can convince the judge or the jury that's going to win.
And I think I'm not an attorney either. But that's why, you know, I encourage people to listen to Matt Flynn, the show After Hours, because he is an attorney. He does a great job laying things out. But I think that's why you have a grand jury, Mike, because it is a grand jury of your peers. You have to present the evidence. The jury then, it's not the prosecutor who decides whether or not the suspect is, you know, gets the indictment.
Sure.
It's the grand jury based on the evidence that you present them. And sometimes, if Matt Flynn says, hey, you can indict a ham sandwich. So sometimes it's not too hard to get the indictment. Then it goes to trial. And it has to be a trial of your peers. And I believe that everyone is innocent until proven guilty. I can have an opinion about that. But I still believe that everyone is entitled to a fair trial, including Donald Trump.
I agree. And same thing if it ends up being Hunter Biden or Joe Biden.
Sure.
This much I'll say. I do believe this. If Trump was not running for president, this would not be going on. And I agree with your statement before that everybody should be prosecuted if they've committed a crime.
Right.
But I think if they indict him again and he's found nothing again, like they have two or three or four times with the impeachments,
right,
and the other things, if that's the case, they're going to keep going after this guy until he's no longer president.
Mike, really appreciate the call there, Marshfield. Thank you so much for listening. I'm up against the clock. I want to get everybody in. Let's go to Joe in Madison. Joe, you got about a minute and 20 seconds. It's all yours. Go ahead, Joe in Madison.
Thank you for the timeline. I hope you repeat it again because it was really helpful and gave great information. I would say in response to the caller, I believe his name is Mike, who just called, thank him for calling. But I would refer him to what Mark had said previous to this, which is that every single person who participated in this had a duty not to Donald Trump, but to the Constitution. Their duty was not to reelect Trump. Their duty was to the Constitution. There were over 60 cases that Trump lost about the election. And he had the opportunity when January 6th got started to do something about it. He could see what was happening there, and he stood in his office and watched it on television as the mayhem that happened, the police officers that were injured and had bear spray sprayed in their eyes. He did not have he told the National Guard to stand down. They didn't participate, and he stood still for hours.
Joe, I agree with you very much. Sorry, I got up against a break. Joe and Madison, thanks for calling. Back and more after this. Don't go anywhere. Hour 2 straight ahead on the Todd Allball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network.